So now I want to talk about antibody structure and antibody diversity again. So here I've drawn an antibody. Again, this could also be called an immunoglobulin. I've drawn it in the soluble version, but this could easily be a version that's embedded in the plasma membrane of a B cell and therefore be a B cell receptor. So you'll recognize two identical heavy chains, two identical light chains. So I want to give you a little bit more information about the structure. So first of all, the direction that the protein runs is from the N-terminus, that is where the variable region lies, to the C-terminus, which is where the constant region lies. So hopefully N and C-terminus, you remember those concepts from biochemistry, the amino terminus and the carboxy terminus of the protein, the beginning and the end of the protein. And the way that relates to the gene, if you recall, genes run from the 5' end to the 3' end. That's how they're read, 5 to 3, N to C. So the 5' end of the gene encodes for the N-terminus or the amino terminus of the protein. So that's the case for the heavy chains. For the light chains, same thing. The N-terminus or the amino terminus of the light chains, that's where you're going to find the variable region. The carboxy terminus of the light chains are going to be internal to the antibody. And again, going back to the light chain gene, 5 to 3, N to C. So when we learned about the variable regions of the heavy chain protein, and I've drawn them there in yellow, those are the variable regions of the heavy chain protein, they're going to be generated from the 5' end of the heavy chain gene. And the same thing is going to be true of the light chain protein. So the variable region of the light chain protein is going to be generated from the 5' end of the light chain gene. So that's a little bit about the structure of the genes and the structure of the proteins. The other thing that we want to talk about is that this structure, immunoglobulins or antibodies, are extremely stable. Why are they so stable? It's because they are held together by disulfide bonds. So hopefully you learned in biochemistry or recall biochemistry, there's a certain amino acid that can participate in a disulfide bond formation, and you should know what that amino acid is. And so this structure, these heavy chains are held together by disulfide bonds, and the light and heavy chains are held together by disulfide bonds. And this is all occurring in the constant regions of the light chain protein and the heavy chain protein. This is not occurring in the variable regions. So the structure, extremely stable. Let's talk a little bit more about nomenclature for the structure of immunoglobulins. The region of immunoglobulins or antibodies that contain the light chain protein and the antigen binding site are known as the FAB fragment. So that would be the FAB fragment. I should write that there. And the reason we give it this name is because in some instances, this whole thing can get cleaved off and participate in some activities in the body. So these are the FAB fragments of antibodies. The part down here is called the FC region, the C standing for constant. So the FAB, that would be where the antigen binding region is. That's the FAB fragment. The FC region of immunoglobulins or antibodies, that is the region where you just have the heavy chain protein linked together via disulfide bonds. And the FC region is going to be important when we're talking about different types of antibodies and the different functions of antibodies. Why is the FC region going to be important? Well, we're going to see that there are proteins that bind the FC region of antibodies. So you got to know the structure of the antibodies so you can know about the FC region, so you can know about things that bind to them. The other thing about the FC region that's important is that it can be different between different isotypes of antibodies. So we haven't touched on this yet, but let's touch on it now. You can make different types of antibodies or different isotypes of antibodies or immunoglobulins. We can call them that as well. And we should probably call them immunoglobulins. They've got these names IgM, IgA, IgG, IgD, and IgE. So all of them can exist as soluble antibodies that get secreted, or they can exist bound in the surface of a membrane. So they can be membrane-bound surface immunoglobulin, which would therefore be part of the B cell receptors. So these all can participate as being B cell receptors. And so the Fc region of each of these different antibody isotypes differs between one another. So if you look at, for example, the IgM antibody, so let's say you secrete this antibody IgM. So the region of the antibody that is the Fc region of IgM is actually called the Fc mu region. So that's the Greek letter mu for M. So that genetic information that comes from the heavy chain gene is actually going to code for the Fc mu region of IgM. And this is going to be different in different antibody isotypes. So, for example, IgA. IgA, it has an Fc region, but its Fc region is different than IgM. So now these different antibody isotypes or immunoglobulin isotypes, they are different from one another. So the IgA immunoglobulin, its heavy chain constant region, the Fc region, comes from a different piece of DNA, and we'll talk about the structure of the heavy chain gene in a coming up video. But the Fc region of the IgA molecule would be known as the Fc alpha constant region. So that's a Greek letter alpha there. IgG would come from the Fc, would be called the Fc gamma region there. IgD is Fc delta, that's the Greek letter delta. And IgE is Fc epsilon. So I know this seems a little confusing now, and it is going to be confusing until we start talking about the genetic information that codes for different constant regions. So that's a weird term. I just said different constant regions. How can something be constant and different? Well, we'll see that upcoming, that all these antibodies, they're different isotypes, so their Fc regions are different from one another. So you have different versions of antibodies. So believe me when I say now that later this will make much more sense. But that's why we need to talk about the Fc region of antibodies. You need to know the Fc region and what region I'm referring to, because it can be different in different antibody isotypes. So let's go back to talking about antibody diversity, which is what we touched on in the previous video. So let's say you're infected by some pathogen. I'm not showing you the whole pathogen. Let's say this is a virus, and this is the surface of the virus. So let's say on the surface of the virus, there's some proteins and some carbohydrates and some lipids. So it has a certain shape, a certain three-dimensional structure. So when you are infected, hopefully pathogens are drained into your lymph nodes, and in the lymph nodes or other lymphatic tissue, you're going to have B cells or B lymphocytes coming in and trying to recognize the pathogen. So here is a B cell number one. It's got an immunoglobulin on its surface, so that would be its B cell receptor, and it has some antigen binding site, right? So the antigen binding site would attempt to bind antigen. Now, the shape that is generated in this B cell, in its antigen binding site, doesn't bind this antigen. It doesn't have affinity for this epitope. So this B cell would be completely useless for this infection. So it would go away. Here comes another B cell with its B cell receptor, and it has another antigen binding site. It is different. It is, but it is specific to some certain shape. Is it going to bind this pathogen? No, its shape doesn't fit very well either. Here's another B cell. It has an antigen binding site with some very specific, distinct shape. It will attempt to bind the antigen, but it will not because its shape doesn't fit. So this seems a little weird that you would make B cells that wouldn't recognize an infection. But that is why the body makes billions upon billions, if not trillions, of different B cell receptors or antigen binding sites. So this concept is known as antibody diversity. And thankfully, we can generate trillions of different antigen binding sites. So this shape here of this antigen
it was not recognized by any of those B cells. And in fact, most B cells will not randomly have happened to make a shape in its antigen binding site that will recognize this antigen. So it might take millions of different B cells to come by and look at this antigen binding site, or look at this antigen to see if it binds it. The concept of antibody diversity, we're going to see, occurs via three different mechanisms. So all of the B cells that came and tried to bind this antigen and couldn't, but may hopefully one will, the shapes of antigen binding sites are determined by three different mechanisms, and these will be upcoming videos. So the first one we've alluded to is somatic recombination, or VDJ recombination. So in the heavy chain gene and the light chain gene, we're going to cut and paste DNA such that the amino acid structure in the variable regions are different between different B cells. So that's the first thing that generates antibody diversity. The second thing is a process known as junctional diversity, separate process. And the third thing is the combination of different heavy chains and light chains. And we'll see that when we talk about the different genes that code for heavy and light chains. So there might be millions of B cells that come by, check this pathogen, say, nope, I don't bind it. My antigen binding site doesn't have the right shape. So here's a B cell, you know, 8,675,309, right? It just happened to have antibody diversity occur on it that it made a perfectly nice shape that has really nice affinity for this antigen, so the epitope on this antigen. And it just randomly made that, right? And this B cell has been randomly circulating in the body for days or weeks looking for something to bind, and now it has bound it. So this process is known as B cell activation, and that'll be in a much later video, because now that this B cell has bound and recognized a pathogen, we need to unleash the fury of the humoral immune system, and that's going to involve these processes: mitosis to make more of these B cells, affinity maturation, which is going to improve the immunoglobulin, it will evolve to be even better. Isotype switching, which is going to make different types of antibodies to combat the infection. And then the B cells will differentiate or turn into plasma cells, which we'll see that secrete antibodies, and memory cells, which will give you lifelong protection. So this was a brief introduction to what generates antibody diversity, as well as talking about the structure of antibodies or immunoglobulins. We'll get into the nitty-gritty of how the antibody diversity occurs in this series of next videos.